often on this show, I like to talk about what we can learn from the great masters. And frequently, those great masters are great gurus of the East, great teachers and philosophies of the past. But of course, there are many great masters that still are found in the world today and in every generation. And we live in a world of information. People can write books and distribute information online. And we are fortunate to be able to access the teachings of so many wise people and learn from them. And today I want to talk about some of the work of one of the better known masters of our world today, and that is Dan Millman. Many of you might know him from his classic book, The Way of the Peaceful Warrior. He's written a number of books, and he is someone who, like many people who end up discovering a spiritual path, he got there through great physical trauma to his body, where after being a champion gymnast and enduring serious injury, thought he'd really never be able to walk again. And that kind of extreme stress and life-threatening challenge frequently is what pushes people to seek for spiritual life or answers. There's no teacher that teaches us anything we haven't heard before, but one of the great things about listening to a contemporary teacher is that they speak in a language that we can understand. They speak of familiar things that we can understand. So Millman, in his many books, has developed a number of core principles from his own knowledge and from his own learning that are core principles that help us develop ourselves and develop our spiritual sense and mostly become better people. And I would like to talk about 10 of those principles today so that we can easily access. It's things that we can all do and all understand and improve our body, mind, and spirit in the process. The first principle that Millman speaks of is self-worth. And as an astrologer, I know that this is the very cornerstone of why some people are able to achieve what they want in life and why not, whether it be personal or professional or anything else. We now live in a world where we have so much freedom to be who we want to be and to pursue what we want to do, that while that's a great thing, it often leaves us a little bit at sea when it comes to understanding where do we stand in the greater scheme of things. In previous times, people were born into a situation which often created issues of class and caste. And it's great that we've moved on from a time when you were not free to be who you want to be. But now we stand in a situation where we don't know how to measure our own worth. And Millman points out that it's often true that the people who are most sensitive, most reflective, the people with the highest visions and ideals are often the people who have the lowest sense of self-worth. Because when we deal with ideals and bigger things like that, we often have very high standards of what it means to be a human being. And how do we then measure up against those high standards? Worst of all, it can lead to situations where we punish ourselves or limit ourselves because of that. Millman likes to quote George Bernard Shaw, who says, "The ignorant are cocksure and the intelligent are full of doubt," something that is a bit of wisdom for us all. But this is the important thing that he says. He says, "You are no more or less worthy than any other person or any part of reality. Your sense of worth grows by doing what is worthy. You don't have to feel worthy. You only have to treat yourself as you would treat a loved one or an honored guest. And that's how you end self-destructive behaviors or self-sabotage and open yourself to life's opportunity." A typical Millman practical solution. Rather than trying to figure out what is your worth, treat yourself like an honored guest. And like that, you'll get the benefit of self-worth. The second of Millman's principles for everyday enlightenment is about acting with will. We often use that word willpower when it comes to stopping a bad habit or doing something that we find really difficult to do. And the truth is that most things are easier said than done. So we find ourselves in a situation where we feel unable to act with will. Willpower, such as giving up a habit or whatever, is the power to directly engage and influence our world. And once we understand that will is about action, it's not about some mysterious quality, like, how do I get the willpower to do something? Willpower is about doing. So it's really just about acting on whatever your intention is. Even the smallest action, just the first action, is what creates willpower, as it were. Because as Millman says, everything is easier said than done. He goes on to say, no matter how intelligent you are, and no matter how talented you are, it's your actions that shape your destiny. It's not your intentions, it's not your thoughts, it's what you actually do. A lot of Millman's philosophy is about doing rather than thinking or idealizing, a lot of what he says. And that's why his book called Everyday Enlightenment is so accessible to us, because it's practical. And the most practical thing of all is doing what you intend to do, doing what you believe is possible. Whether or not it fails or succeeds is not the point. It is the action that is the point, because when we act with will. Acting on our own intention is the reward in itself. That's why the first step to willpower is always action. And that's how we conquer those bad habits or create good new ones. And that's what leads us to the third principle of creating a more enlightened everyday life. And that is about creating positive habits. We find it difficult to create positive habits. It's obviously a much better plan of action than struggling to overcome bad habits. And that is to create positive habits. We can even look at overcoming bad habits as being about creating positive habits. For example, instead of saying, I must remove the habit of smoking, we should be saying, I must create the habit of not smoking. And so creating habits, in order to create them, Millman points out they need to be as convenient as possible. Make the positive behavior as convenient as possible. So if you have a habit of smoking, then keep one box of cigarettes at home. Don't keep cigarettes handy. Keep it difficult to get hold of in the house, locked in a cupboard or high up where you have to reach it. Or if you've got a habit of snacking at night, then do something like put your toothbrush and your toothpaste right next to your dinner table. Brush your teeth immediately after dinner. That's going to make you not want to snack. I mean, you might still have the urge, but it's starting to become inconvenient because then you're going to have to brush your teeth again. So using some forms of positive reinforcement of the new good habit in order to do that. Keeping things that create the bad habits or enforce the bad habits out of your reach, keeping things which create the good habits and reinforce the new habits immediately within your reach. It's pretty much as easy as that. You still have to take the action. But remember, the previous step to enlightenment is acting with will. So if you've got a toothbrush and toothpaste next to you at the dinner table, your will is to say, I will immediately brush my teeth. You've taken a step towards the positive behavior. It's harder to do the negative behavior, and you're beginning to change your life from acting with will. When it comes to acting with will, or acting in any other way at all, we've all heard the expression, seize the day. The time to act is essentially now. But Millman points out that's a little bit wrong. That doesn't really mean now. When we say seize the day, a day is a 24-hour period. And as we know, a lot happens in that 24 hours. So seize the day itself can be a little overwhelming and seem kind of a little bit impossible. A day, says Millman, is made up of many different moments, and each moment might produce something different. So rather than seizing the day, we should seize the moment. Millman says it is the quality of your moments that produces the quality of your life. As thoughts come and go and the waves of mind rush on, seize the moment. He uses the expression carpe punctum, which means seize the moment, as opposed to the well-known carpe diem, seize the moment. Millman says, every moment deserves your full attention because it will not come again. And when you realize that, rather than talking about the shortness of life, rather than talking about this day will never repeat itself, if you understand that your life is in a series of moments, and that ties in with this rushing mind that we have that says, do this, don't do that, I meant to do this, it's still today, maybe I'll do that before 5 o'clock. All of those things actually create a lot more scatteredness, stress, and often means that we don't get round to doing something. If we understand that there are only moments, we're not going to say, I'll do that in 10 moments time. It focuses us on the present, a very important principle we'll talk about again. It focuses us on the present. It helps us understand this is the moment. This moment will never occur again. So I will act in this moment. And that helps us fulfill the do it now approach, which is at the core of Millman's philosophy. It's one thing to seize the moment. It's one thing to say, act now. But the easier said than done part of that is that there often are circumstances which prevent us from acting. The most significant of those circumstances, the one that has the most power to prevent us and block us, is fear. Fear of the outcome, fear of whatever is out there that looks so terrifying that stops us from engaging in that action. Millman says, those are not your fears. Your major battles, says Millman, your major battles with fear are not outside you. They lurk inside, in the caverns of the psyche, in the arena of psychological survival and dark imaginings, where fear shapeshifts into subtle guises such as self-doubt, insecurity, lack of confidence, shyness, inhibition, timidity, a reluctance to assert, to express, even to be yourself. He goes on to say, whatever form your fear takes, your willingness to face it squarely will determine your fate in the high country of human potential. And as overwhelming as it might be to think your fears lurk inside, not outside, the profoundly empowering thing about that is it means they are accessible, that you can do something about them. If the monster is a dragon out there threatening you, there's nothing much you can do yourself about that except put armor around yourself, which is going to make it even worse. If the fear comes from within you, then you have the power to address it because, well, as we know from the Stoics, that is the only realm where you have power. And once you realize that's where you have power, you can face those fears or doubts or fear of being yourself. And addressing that will give you the power you need to do whatever you need to do in the world, because nothing out there becomes fearful. Of course, frequently, what stops us from acting is the past experience of pain or fear of pain. Fear, remember, is one of those demons that comes from inside, not from outside. But pain is a teacher. Suffering is a teacher. Millman says, pain is a relatively objective, physical phenomenon. Suffering is our psychological resistance to what happens. A friend of mine always says, pain is a real thing. Suffering is what happens when you think about it. So Millman says, events may create physical pain, but they in themselves do not create suffering. Resistance creates suffering. Stress happens when your mind resists what is. If your spouse leaves you, if your lover leaves you, the amount of stress or suffering each of you experiences depends on the meaning you place on the event. If you believe it to be good that you are now free, you suffer less. If you believe it is bad that you're now alone, you suffer more. The only problem in life is your mind's resistance to life as it actually is, life as it unfolds. As soon as we learn to accept what is and use our mental powers to turn it into something more positive, we can free ourselves from suffering, because suffering is the mind engaging in our pain. Life is what it is. That stuff happens. It's all about how we react to it. As the Stoics have often said to us, that's where we have our control over our reactions. So if we learn to react with a little bit of detachment and we try and see what is positive in the thing which has caused us pain, we don't suffer. We have the power to remove suffering from our own lives. Well, sometimes pain is overwhelming and we don't like pain and we get overwhelmed by it and our life grinds to a halt when tragedy happens or trauma happens, or even when, for whatever reason, we're feeling depressed. Very often our life winds down and grinds to a halt. We don't do anything. And we sit there as often it gets worse because, of course, we're neglecting our duties. We're neglecting what needs to be done because we feel overwhelmed by our emotions. But Millman says the lesson of the enlightened is that emotions don't rule our lives. As others have said, we have emotions, but we are not our emotions. So we don't have to like our emotions. We don't have to love our emotions. But Millman says we have to accept our emotions, as difficult as that can be at times. It's not the emotion that is the problem that creates that negative experience. The problem is what follows that emotion when we stop doing, when we drop out of school, when we stop doing our work, when we put our family or duties on hold until we can work out our emotional issues. Millman goes on to say, would you rather feel depressed while sitting alone in your room trying to figure it all out, or feel depressed while getting your house clean or your project completed? You could still feel depressed, but you'll have a clean house at the end of it. It sounds flippant, but he says the heart of accepting your emotions and reclaiming your will is to do what you need to do despite what you are feeling. Accept and learn from your feelings, but do not let them run your life. By remaining productive during difficult emotional episodes, you're more likely to improve your emotional state than if you do nothing, sitting around waiting for sunny skies. It's the truth. It's going to actually enable you to improve your emotional state because you're producing rewarding results from acting on your will and reaching one step further to a sense of enlightenment. Now we come to those enlightened principles that I think are the most profound of all, just the last three that I'm going to talk about. And remember, there's much more in Millman's work. Firstly, it's the understanding that life is a series of moments. I've mentioned it before. Millman has spoken about seizing the moment before. But getting back to that idea is because so many great teachers say live in the present. Millman says, remember that no one feels the same all the time. If you're angry or depressed or crazy or afraid or grieving, there'll be moments when you're distracted. Similarly, there are no enlightened people. There are no nice people, bad people, smart people, neurotic people, stupid people. There are only people with more or less enlightened, nice, bad, smart, neurotic, or stupid moments. There are more or less enlightened moments, not so smart moments, because life is lived in the moment. Let go of the past. Let go of any labels you apply to yourself or someone else, and just be present. Be present in the moment. You could be enlightened just for a moment, rather than saying, I'm an enlightened person, I'm not an enlightened person, I'm an angry person. It allows for so much more self-acceptance, and it allows us to seize some of the moments despite what else is going on. You could be in grief or pain or anger. That doesn't mean you have to stop living what it means to be a human being, or the potential to fulfill your potential or achieve some greater sense of enlightenment, at least for now, for right now, which might not be the same as in 5 minutes' time, but that's okay, because there only is right now. Life is a series of moments. If you're enlightened for a moment, it's okay if you're angry for another, and you could be enlightened for another one afterwards. That's what enlightenment is. Then we have a teaching about love, principle that many great teachers, of course, refer to. We know that love is the only permanent thing, survives death even. Love is the only meaningful thing. Connections between people, things, living things, non-living things, seems to be the only thing that really is real. Millman says, awaken the heart. Love begins with you. He says, one of the strangest delusions believed by many of us is that it is good to love other people, but bad to love yourself. I suggest, he says, that the more you are able to see, love, and accept the one facet of spirit gazing at you from the mirror, the more you will be able to love spirit within others. If we are the same awareness shining through billions of different forms, then all love begins with self-love. For the heart to awaken, it cannot exclude a single soul, including yourself. If you do not love yourself, how can you find the space to love others? Finally, for today, the last principle of everyday enlightenment that I want to mention is, of course, the one of service. Serve the world. We all know that the greatest gift to ourselves is to gift others in some way. To give is one of the things that seems to elevate ourselves more than anything else. Millman says, as you transcend your own limitations and tendencies, you will naturally show loving kindness to others. As your own light shines more brightly, you illuminate the world. And it's true. The more we feel good about ourselves, the more we want everyone to feel good. The more we radiate happiness, brightness, positivity into our world, so much so that we literally have the urge to give that to others. So Millman says, find a form of service that calls to you, that suits your abilities, your aptitudes, your qualities and interests, one that makes time fly by and that draws from you your best, that tells you you have arrived home and found yourself. So within each of us is that self that feels at its best when others feel at their best. And why? Because as we've just seen, we are the other. If spirit is in me, then spirit is in you. It is the same spirit that looks back at me. So in giving you my light and my warmth and my enlightenment and my positivity and whatever it is I have to give, I give it to myself, I give it to us all, and I get the same reward that you do. That's why we do that. So it's the smallest acts of kindness that allow us to give to the world. Whether it's a small thing like picking up a piece of trash as you're walking along, or, you know, paying for someone's one or two rand that they're missing at the counter when they're standing there scratching through their purse. Little acts of kindness that make all the difference. We've all heard it before. The smallest acts of kindness make the biggest difference. Try and do one of those little things every day. You will feed and grow your spirit through the millions of people around you. And that, of course, is the easiest way to achieve enlightenment, awareness, and the positive understanding of the human experience, just by giving it to everyone around you and seeing it reflected back at you. Because what is reflected back at you, as the mirror tells you, is you.